So today I'm going to talk about Hashimoto's encephalopathy. This is continuing a series of talks in which I'm going to do some explanations or present some medical conditions which can sometimes, between not infrequently or quite often, present with symptoms of psychosis that can very much resemble schizophrenia. And thus leading into the rationale for this talk, there are, as this audience knows, but just to reiterate, many possible causes of psychosis. This disease entity that gets the name schizophrenia, which is probably a host of different illnesses which have roughly similar symptoms. The schizophrenia cannot be diagnosed if those symptoms are better explained by some other psychiatric process or by some medical process. That's like criterion D from the DSM. Therefore, we need to always be thinking about possible medical causes and ruling things out. Thyroid disease, including autoimmune thyroiditis, is very well known to impact many facets of mental status and mood and behavior and thinking. So thinking about thyroid illness is certainly relevant to trying to understand possible medical causes of psychosis or to rule out medical causes when a diagnosis of schizophrenia is being entertained. So today, let's focus on the most prominent and interesting of autoimmune thyroid presentations, Hashimoto's encephalopathy. I'm going to tell you today what is Hashimoto's encephalopathy, how it can relate to psychosis, and give you a top-level overview of symptoms, diagnosis, incidence, and treatment. So first, let's meet Dr. Hashimoto himself. He was a physician from Japan. He published a paper in 1912 in which he described four cases of women who had had goiter, and upon histologic examination was found to have lymphocytic infiltrates. This was taken as an autoimmune process to a thyroid disease, and he didn't name it for himself, but ultimately his name became attached to autoimmune thyroiditis or autoimmune hypothyroidism. Hashimoto's thyroiditis is different than Hashimoto's encephalopathy. Hashimoto's thyroiditis is actually pretty common as far as diseases go, affecting in general 1-2% of the US population, and amongst Caucasians in the US about 5%. Most common demographic is middle-aged women, although it can happen to anybody at any time. Typical symptoms are basic clinical features of hypothyroidism, temperature sensitivity, fatigue, constipation, weight gain, possibly mood changes. And to make a diagnosis of Hashimoto's thyroiditis, you have clinical signs, laboratory signs of thyroid hormone secretion impairment, as well as the presence of thyroid-directed antibodies. Speaking of thyroid-directed antibodies, a couple of things I want to make mention, especially since these lectures go on YouTube, and there might be people who are, more inclined or very inclined to look at supplements and think that iodine is a useful thing. Certainly one would think that iodine is a useful thing because iodine deficiency causes thyroid disease in the form of goiter. This lead to the incorrect assumption that overcompensating for iodine would be a good thing. And actually, when we're exposed to excessive iodine, two things happen. Immune cells become more sensitive to looking for foreign invaders, so it functions as an adjuvant, an immune system stimulator. And also, iodine causes basically churning of thyroid stimulating hormone and other sorts of thyroid communication molecules, leading to alternate splicing of those proteins, making them potentially antigenic. So on the one hand, you have subtle variations in the forms of proteins like thyroglobulin or thyroperoxidase. And at the same time, with excessive iodine, you have an immune system more likely or more sensitive to detecting subtle changes in protein structure. And that would be a setup for developing thyroid-directed antibodies. Also, super tiny literature, but if further replicated and expanded would be very worrisome. It does appear that antipsychotic-induced hyperprolactinemia is maybe a risk factor for developing thyroid antibodies. So, but, and aside from that, there's probably, you know, who knows how many other pathways to directing to developing autoimmunity. These are just two that came up in my searching around this topic recently. So let's move on to encephalopathy. I'm going to talk about Hashimoto's encephalopathy, but just to be everybody on the same page, encephalopathy is comes from Greek words that literally mean brain suffering. Neurologic, and that's different from encephalitis. So our neurology colleagues use two terms that have similar roots, encephalitis and encephalopathy. Encephalitis is a brain disorder associated with inflammation, and encephalopathy just means brain disorder. Oftentimes brain disorder without evidence of inflammation, but that's, you can have encephalopathy with inflammatory processes as well. And you saw me struggling for words because encephalopathy is, you know, kind of like as broad as mental status change in its meaning. So it can mean many different things and have many different pathways. Roughly speaking, encephalopathies, you know, do involve mental status changes, cognitive disruptions, delirium-like changes of level of consciousness, and any number of classical psychiatric changes of mood, thought, mania, or psychosis, as well as any number of neurological signs going from vague to specific. So gait disturbance, speech quality disturbance, jerky muscle movements, tremors, seizures, and so forth. So that encephalopathy, broadly speaking, is a brain pathology leading to global changes of cognition and motor function. So Hashimoto's encephalopathy. This was, interestingly, I put this bullet point down. I thought this is a great name for a neurologist, Russell Bain. Russell Brain, Dr. Brain, was the one who brought us the name Hashimoto's encephalopathy. Brain, who is actually an eminent neurologist in Great Britain at the time, described a case of a 48-year-old man who had garden variety Hashimoto's thyroiditis. But in this case of proven Hashimoto's thyroiditis, there were also recurrent neuropsychiatric symptoms. So the patient would experience episodes of psychosis, often along with neurological changes like ataxia and seizure. These were repeated episodes, self-limiting but recurrent. And so it was thought to be an encephalopathy variation or an exacerbation of Hashimoto's thyroiditis that led to encephalopathic changes. Interestingly and key for our discussion is that many of these encephalopathic episodes occurred when the patient was in a euthyroid state. So this wasn't due to a change of thyroid hormones. This was by some other process. So this brings us to definition. Relapsing encephalopathy, I say usually relapsing because there are some descriptions of more or less constant psychosis or neuropsychiatric changes, which sort of, you know, wax and wane in intensity without ever actually relapsing. So there can be those variations, and it is by definition associated with Hashimoto's thyroiditis, which means by definition is associated with thyroid antibodies. It has some other names which are, I think, a little bit better than an eponym because they get to describing at least clinical features. One of the alternative names is called STREET, steroid responsive encephalopathy associated with autoimmune thyroiditis, or neurologic disorder associated with thyroid autoimmunity. So those are the names and the definitions. Okay. Symptoms, I alluded to earlier, encephalopathy, and encephalopathy can mean anything, a combination of psychiatric changes and neurological changes typically occurring together, although it's been reported that between 20 and 30% of patients with Hashimoto's encephalopathy have primarily psychiatric symptoms. So that's that. And again, you can have the whole range of psychiatric symptoms. You can have psychosis as a prominent or a predominant sign. and it may or may not be associated with global neurological symptoms as well. And as I mentioned earlier, can appear in the setting of normal thyroid hormone and normal thyroid stimulating hormone levels, and can appear without prodromal signs or clinical signs of hypothyroidism. So it can appear in people that have not had changes of temperature, sensitivity, unexplained changes of weight, or mood changes related to thyroid hormone deficiencies. Makes it an interesting and challenging thing to think about, actually. How to diagnose? I guess the definitive diagnosis is the presence of antibodies directed against thyroid peroxidase. Thyroid peroxidase is a protein which is involved in the preparation of iodine to incorporate into the storage protein thyroglobulin. Antibodies against thyroid peroxidase are present in almost all cases of Hashimoto's encephalopathy. The other protein that frequently we can generate antibodies against, the other thyroid protein that we can generate antibodies against, is thyroglobulin. This is a protein which stores the thyroid hormone. But many patients with Hashimoto's encephalopathy will have no detectable elevations of antibodies against thyroglobulin. So it's not a specific marker. TPO or thyroid peroxidase antibody is the one. However, final bullet point, confusing, it's not definitively diagnostic because you can see up to 1 in 5 people in general population with an obvious illness can have significant levels of antibodies directed against thyroid peroxidase. So you have to have encephalopathic or significant mental status changes in combination with the antibody being positive. If you have those two, then you'll find that some form of EEG abnormality is present in the majority of cases, about 90% by estimation. And these as well are typically just periodic generation of abnormal presence of so-called slow waves in the EEG. So not highly specific EEG signatures, but you see intrusion of a lot of slow waves either constantly or episodically in many of these cases. And to reiterate, pre-morbid or pre-existing hypothyroidism is actually typically, in majority of cases, not present in Hashimoto's in Hashimoto's encephalopathy. How you wind up from antibodies against thyroid hormones into the development of psychosis, for example, is, as Dr. Chirilov pointed out, an enigma of thyroidology and psychiatry. Actually, if anybody can get to a really detailed explanation of how any process can lead to the experience of psychosis, this will be a major advancement. But there are several things have been, you know, implicated in this process, and probably all three of these things interact with each other. So first, you can have the direct activation or the direct action of the antibodies against the target proteins. So antibodies against thyroid peroxidase binding to thyroid peroxidase and generating the immune response to the active antigen antibody complex. Key point as well, and probably more relevant to that, is that the antibodies directed against the thyroid and thyroid protein can easily cross-react with other proteins on nerve cells. So that may be how we disrupt brain processes. Related to this is you can have inflammation and therefore disruption of oxygen and blood flow due to vasculitis. And finally, you can then have the direct or secondary effects of long-term abnormal regulation of thyroid hormones. So all these things have been implicated together. How to treat? This is why it becomes important to think about screening for this, because third bullet point, antipsychotic medications at best are moderately helpful, not completely so, and may actually in some cases worsen the clinical picture. Getting the right diagnosis will lead to prompt, usually glucocorticoid treatment like prednisone, which can be very effective in the majority of cases. There are some other immune modulating treatments that can be done and can be successful. And also it's helpful, it's very useful to keep thyroid hormone levels in the normal range, because those themselves can function as a brake on an overactive immune system in autoimmune diseases. How common is this? This is where we get into the very deep woods now, because official estimates is pretty rare, 2 cases per 100,000, leading to roughly 400 cases reported in the entire world medical literature since first described about 20 years ago. However, if you look at groups of patients with schizophrenia or psychiatric illness, you see some pretty eye-popping statistics with thyroid-directed antibodies, like the thyroid peroxidase antibody. 20% with thyroid antibodies in one sample, 14% versus 6% in another sample, nearly 30% with abnormal thyroid status in schizophrenia spectrum patients, and 15% of consecutively screened individuals with schizophrenia being positive for thyroid antibodies. So these numbers are, you know, lead us to wonder if it's more common than we imagine, which leads to the golden question of what do we do about this? And here we get to another set of uncertainties. So we do typically screen for a thyroid stimulating hormone and may or may not screen for just thyroid hormone levels, T3 or T4, as a routine practice, which is not a bad routine practice. Should we though screen for antibodies like for thyroid peroxidase? And if we do, with positive antibodies, we'll see positive antibody screens in between 2% to 20% of otherwise normal individuals. So we'll get a lot of false positives, and we'll get many cases in which we'll have a moderate elevation of the antibody, which is not really clearly leading us to any particular diagnosis. So we'll have a lot of head scratching if we do this. And that's probably why no professional organization has put out practice guidelines that says, yes, screen for thyroid peroxidase in all your patients. However, it does, you know, I think it may be worthwhile to know if the person has a very high level of thyroid peroxidase antibody, especially since we've seen the majority of cases of Hashimoto's encephalopathy occur without pre-existing thyroid disease, and can occur with normal thyroid hormone levels. So I think it's probably worthwhile to measure. Also, interestingly, individuals with schizophrenia in the case of the Barbero study, or with major depression in the case of the Shen study, that have thyroid antibodies have either higher risk for suicide or higher levels of psychosis symptoms or greater functional impairment. So it's at least a marker for a clinical outcome that we may want to pay attention to. And it may or may not turn out to be a marker of an actionable autoimmune disease that can lead to a more definitive treatment. So I'm going to leave it as an open question, but as I think I probably led by my statements here, I'm more inclined to trying to add this as a routine screen, so at least we have the opportunity to scratch our heads and think about and know that we've looked for every possible thing, rather than not looking for things and then having somebody be missed.